It's really a great pleasure to introduce tonight our first lecture of the spring semester, Christian Kerez, coming from Zurich and Berlin, and clearly one of the rising stars of architecture today. For me, this became particularly obvious at the last Venice Architecture Biennale, curated by Alejandro Aravena, where Kerez's interventions had one of the most memorable presence. On the one hand, there was in his installation Incidental Space for the Swiss Pavillion in the Giardini, a surreal object like an explosion of foam, seemingly with an exterior, but actually as you kind of moved around with nooks and crannies and a kind of really interesting interior. The object seemed to speak about presence, or rather a kind of ephemeral presence, about process, an object that had its own life, an experiment with its own rules, and that really used the space of the exhibition to explore questions about architecture, how it's made, perceived, inhabited, and what are new formal, or rather in this case maybe formless, sort of properties and possibilities for its presence. And then on the other hand, and at the other end, in a way, of the biennial was Kerez's participation in the Italian pavilion, where he filled half a room with his project for the Porto Seguro social housing in Brazil, a project he's worked on for 3 years, or from 2010 to 2013. And there, looking at this question of social housing, were drawings sort of at all scales, both of the housing at the scale of the neighborhood, but also many, many drawings of the different units, trying to really kind of get into questions of morphology, organization, aggregation. There were models, kind of really a real investigation in terms of understanding that housing. And so in many ways, while these two projects registered something quite unique and different, at the same time, I think they highlighted a uniqueness to Kerez's own approach. While they seemed two opposite investigations at first, and certainly with very little possibility to assume a kind of signature or style or a narrow and immediately recognizable set of interests, with Incidental Space on the one hand as a kind of formal explosion of excess and materiality, and the Porto Seguro social housing on the other as a kind of rigorous analysis of housing aggregation. In fact, the more you thought about it, the more you saw a kind of intersection between the two projects, a kind of same a search for, let's say, a fundamental search about architecture itself. And more specifically, a search of what not is visible, but rather what is invisible, or rather what Kerez has once said to be his interest in discovering the underlying rules of the game, more interesting to him than the game itself, a kind of deep knowledge and discovery of what is underlying architecture. In an interview for his 2009 El Croquis, Kerez says, "The story of a specific project is ultimately a random game variation or a random sample of a rule, but being abstract, it remains invisible. It is communicated only indirectly through the project, and as you say, it's also open to surprises. Ideas are not visible. The moment an architect tries to judge ideas on the basis of their visibility, he's working stylistically or referentially and is no longer addressing the basics." And so his work, while not immediately spectacular, has become internationally and increasingly recognized for its rigor, its internal consistency, its combination of restraint and neutrality with, at the same time, great impact and a sense of timeliness. It's also uniquely hybridized. You can sense his love of Japanese architecture, especially the recent investment in lightness and aggregation, consistency of materials, austerity even, and a certain formlessness, such as with Ishigami or Fujimoto, a kind of hybridizing that works with a European precision and technical expertise in construction, as well as the pursuit of very clear and strong singular architectural entities. But it's also clearly personal and with a special sense of time, I think. And here I could say a little anecdote. We spent this afternoon touring two. That was Kerez's condition for coming to New York. I have to see something interesting. And so we went to Rudolph's beautiful Halston house and to the Modulator. And I have to say, in an age where architects are kind of dropping in and out, including myself, as fast as possible, it was really inspiring to see someone take care and take the time to really see architecture. Christian Kerez was born in 1962 in Venezuela, and he was educated at the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology in Zurich. After extensive published work in the field of architectural photography, he opened his own architectural office in Zurich in 1993. He's currently a professor of design and architecture at ETH and has spent some time in the US. In particular, in 2012, he led the Kenzo Tange Chair at Harvard University's Graduate School of Design. Amongst his key projects are the Kunstmuseum Liechtenstein in Basel, the apartment building on Forterstrasse in Zurich, and the house with one wall also in Zurich, and he received first prize in competition for the Museum of Modern Art in Warsaw in Poland. He's received many awards. Amongst the most recent are the 2015 Wholesome Award in Europe, as well as in 2012 was made a fellow at the Royal Institute of British Architects. Please join me in welcoming Christian Kerez.
Thank you so much, not only for inviting me to New York, but also for spending the entire afternoon with me and for the introduction. How do I switch to the lecture? Okay, good. Actually, you referred to the Biennale of last year. This is also when we met the last time in Europe. And I would like to start the lecture with a project we showed at the Biennale and also finish the lecture with another project. And one project was also kind of shown by invitation by Alessandro Aravena, and the other was actually presented for the first time even before we knew who will be the main curator of the Venice Biennale and before we knew what was the title. So it was like being invited to the same event once through the main gate and once from the backyard. Maybe this is also one of the reasons why these projects are so different. But how they relate to each other, this is what I actually want to kind of work out specifically in this lecture. And in this lecture, I will focus on very few projects. I will only show four to also enhance this specific question, how do these two projects relate to each other. The title of last year's Biennale was Reporting from the Front. And it was supposed to show that, let's say, the field of architecture dramatically changed within the last years. The places where architecture works and also the topics on which they would work, that they are different in terms of what is the social environment or the also changing climate condition and how can these affect architecture. And this, let's say, there were like two titles. If you look carefully, one is the sentence reporting from the front, but the other is, this is much bigger, so I would say this is the headline of the Biennale, is this figure standing on a ladder. And this is a German researcher that was carrying this ladder through the desert to once in a while step on top of it to have a different perspective. And this metaphorical picture was actually also suggesting that it is not only about being involved in actual problems of our time, but it is also about the question, how would these change our perspective, our understanding of architecture? And I would say this is also, for myself, the main interest. If you say sustainability is only a question how you save energy and fuel, sustainability is a technological problem that can also be solved in a technological way. But I think it only can become interesting and relevant for architecture if it raises the question, how will this affect our own understanding, our own design process of architecture? In this sense, we showed one project that was, in reality, a total failure in the sense that it never was built so far. And we worked 5 years on it all together. And it still is a, for us, or let's say for myself, a crucial project, because it helped me to change my own understanding of architecture, because it was a possibility to discover certain possibilities that exist within architecture, but that I was not aware of. So in this sense, the contribution at the Biennale was much more to kind of make clear that if I work in Brazil, if I work on a favela, it is not about kind of teaching other people how they should live or trying other people to make their life better, because I know myself how it should be better, but much more about changing my own awareness or myself restriction. This is a picture of a favela in Sao Paulo, and I would say it's quite crucial to understand that this is one city. What I mean is these high-rise buildings in the background and the favela in the foreground, they belong to each other. The one exists thanks to the other. That people that are living in the favela, they work for people that are living in the towers. And for example, there is a huge hospital for the rich people that live in these towers nearby, where mostly people for, let's say, cleaning and helping come from the favela. And not only that they make a living out of that, but they also get a free treatment. And there is a very close exchange between these two cities. So in this sense, I would also kind of look at it at the favela as a specific urbanistic pattern, which one could also say has many advantages. Not only is the density of a favela much higher than in this example below of modernistic Gropiusstadt in Berlin, but it's also much cheaper, much faster to build. There are much more people living there. It's easier to change. It's more dynamic. So when we were approached by Sehabi Urbanistic Planning Institute of Sao Paulo to make a proposal to upgrade the favela, we actually thought that this is something we cannot do, you know, because the favela as such is pretty well working and also quite beautiful. And so our proposal was, instead of introducing new programs like a theater or new spaces like a basketball field or something like that, to just take the existing quality, which is the density, and develop this density further. Unfortunately, technically, it was not possible. You would have to demolish all the houses underneath. It would be totally new intervention, and the demolishing of the existing favela was then also the reason why we thought it is in the end a very literal and maybe also stupid idea. And I have to admit that this first proposal was done before I ever visited a favela. And these pictures which I'm going to show you now are done through a stroll through a favela for 2 weeks. And I was sightseeing in this favela, and also the pictures are more, I would say, idealization of the favela, and they are more an attempt to capture the beauty of the favela. Not only the obvious, let's say, sculptural quality of these self-fabricated houses, as you can see in the fore and middle ground, but also the specific quality of very small urban spaces which maybe could be called atomized spaces in comparison with a normal or with a modern or classical city as we know it. And these favelas are undergoing constant changes. As you can see on this picture, this is an abandoned house that one of the neighbors used again as a garden. And this garden that is done with PET bottles and sculpture in the background and different plants is let's say, a specific aesthetic or a specific beauty, as it is hard to imagine that a landscape designer, you know, could invent it just working on a blank paper in an atelier. And we thought of the very first project as a kind of a settlement of individual houses, each of the housing units that you see in this floor plan, and there are over 30 different units, is different from each other, to create also an outside space which is constantly changing. This design was done without the knowledge of any, let's say, rules and regulations that exist in Brazil. It's done without knowing how much a unit could or should cost. So in this sense, it's a pure conceptual proposal. But the main contribution is that instead of upgrading the favela, which seemed pretty much okay for us, was that we said we would prefer to extend the favela. And it was also, let's say, a discovery for me personally of a scale which I haven't witnessed, which I haven't experienced to that very moment when I first visited a favela. And this small scale, or kind of the quality of density of space, the labyrinthic quality of a space, was also in the end a triggering point, not only for this project, but also for other projects to come much later. You can see, for example, here that the buildings are nearly touching each other. The space in between here or here is, as it is in an existing favela, 40 or 60 centimeters, so that you can only walk sideways. In this sense, this project would be as illegal as any existing favela. This approach to understand the favela as an equal expression of a village as any other vernacular city is not something new. This is a page out of a book from John Turner, where he compares at the bottom of the page social housing by the government, a South American dictatorship, which is obviously more done to control people than really to create a nice living environment. And this in total opposition to the favela, which is shown on top of this page. And there is nearly no difference in the perspective, in the aesthetic, how the favela is represented in the article by John Turner, as it is shown in the book that you all know by Rudovsky, Architecture Without Architects. But to work within a favela also kind of requires an understanding of the favela that you cannot get just by strolling through or by sightseeing. So this whole project was developed together with a PhD work that was also done nearly in the same period of time by Hugo Mesquita, who was also living in favelas for this project. And we thought a lot about how can we understand the structure of the favela. Many exercises that we did. What you see differentiated in colors is that some houses have different connections, how they relate to the street surrounding this block. For example, there's the typology of the house, which maybe is not standing directly on the street, but is one or even two plots behind it, but has a direct, a private access to the public street. And this typology is not only in the sense of how does it relate to the city, but also how it is built. This is just one overview of all the houses that stand in the second line behind the main streets and are. The plans, they were extremely detailed. Hugo Mesquita drew not only all openings, but also all furniture of each single house, and was talking with all the house owners, you know, what is the story of the house, so that he could not only kind of give a representation of the final favela of the favela, how does it look today, but was also able to tell how the favela grew and the four type case studies that he chose also relate to each other through the ages. One is a very old settlement, the other is a very recent one. And through the overview of these different stages of design, of growing of a favela, we could also assume, you know, how these favelas would develop in the future. And as you can see by looking at the drawings, the favelas are everything but informal. Actually, they are very rigorous. They are done with a lot of understanding of economical issues. They are very disciplined. But the main interest in the end was for us not much the houses themselves, but much more, and this is only the, let's say, interest that you can have if you work with a structure like this. What is the outside space? How do these singular individual housing relate to each other? What do they create as an urban space? And we were thinking of this in many different ways, and one of the exercises, how we approached the urban space, is that we took patterns not only from existing cities, but also from textiles or paintings, and try to scale them. As you can see, there is a house unit here or here, to imagine what could be the urban space that would be possible if all houses are built at the same time by one singular architectural office. And this actually brought us back to the starting point, that with having just a couple of modules, if you would arrange them in a totally differentiated way, that this outside space would also allow to have utmost variety, a much bigger variety than all examples that you saw on the previous picture. This is a differentiation of public, private squares and alleys. And as you can see, this composition that looks at the first hand actually allows a lot of usable space. The space is actually created through only five different houses. Two houses with two levels, two with three, and one with two maisonettes on top of each other. These houses fulfill all the requirements that are given by the state, so that they could also cost between $30,000 and $50,000, which was the given budget. Each house would be repeated 90 times, but always combined in a different way, so that the exterior space would constantly change. The single houses, you know, they maybe are very simple and as such not so exciting or interesting. But for us, the most interesting element in this design was the exterior space. And this exterior space, you can only imagine if you also represent, build all each of these 450 housing units. The project was developed up to the building permit and then abandoned. So building permit was also not really rejected. There was a documentation of over 100 A0s and quite a complicated work to give all the detailed information that was necessary. Instead of building the previous project, this is what was built in the end. Because the plot was occupied by drug dealers who used the drug as a, let's say, real estate operation and also defended their plot, and it became one of the most dangerous places in the whole neighborhood. And therefore, the people of the favela had to organize themselves and occupy a plot from the neighborhood. And this is what they built in the end. It's extremely done in very short time. They occupied the plot and built overnight a city. You can see these are all tent structures and these are built houses. All the single units here, they are just bedrooms, sometimes for individuals, sometimes also for entire families. And they share certain spaces as living rooms or to watch TV or with sanitary facilities, showers, toilets, and so on. The plan had an economy and a rigor that I never would be able to achieve. The exhibition in Venice was titled A Selective Chronology. So it was not, you know, saying how terrible, how bad, we never could build this beautiful project. But it was much more kind of re-evaluating these 5 years to kind of think about all the moments where we captured something that might have an effect on other projects built by others, or maybe that we could build once in the future. And table showing the drawings that Hugo Mesquita did, and otherwise it was a chronology of the entire working process, but only let's say highlighting these elements of the process that we liked, and the other ones we just let disappear. So could also say it's not so much an exhibition, it's much more a work to create an archive of a never built and all these models, they already existed, but they were done in paper or cardboard and were already destroyed a long time ago. And for the Biennale, we just in a different scale. What you see on this table, for example, is an analysis of houses that we found within an existing favela, and on this table, these are examples by the municipality of Sao Paulo, and here are our own trials to come up with new apologies. Nothing.
Is it now better? Okay, sorry about that. So we also didn't design the tables for the exhibition. These tables were actually designed by Carlos Scarpa for the university, and were just a loan of the University for Architecture of Venice. Among other things, you would see also the biggest problem that you would have in building this structure, which is under the ground, the sewage system, studies of the spaces in between the houses, detailed studies, you know, how you could live in a housing unit like that, because these people are not just poor, but they also have TVs and other things. And it was actually rather surprising for us that people would look at these things quite intensely, because we had so many, let's say, shows going on in other spaces where you would have huge video screens and huge models and many different things that were specifically designed just for the Biennale, while we just laid out on a table what we already did a long time before. I don't really believe that there are categories within architecture beyond the experience of the architectural space. I don't think the program, the site, is really something that could define the quality of architecture. In this sense, we didn't, after this project, became specialists of favelas and did many other projects, but certain ideas that were revealed within this project were important for other projects. And the house Okamura, which will be built this year, where we already started the construction site early in January, wouldn't be possible without the experience of the project for the extension of a favela, even if there is not any singular obvious connection in terms of brief or plot. The plot is a bit at the border of Prague. You have a view on the city, but it's maybe not a great view. And this was also one of the reasons why we thought of building a house made up of all with small spaces. I did a series of apartment houses with three apartments in Zurich, and each apartment in these projects was only mainly proposing one singular open space. And this was the opposite. This was a house with 52 spaces. And these spaces themselves are quite small. They are all circular. But the quality is not the single space itself. The quality of the project much more comes from how these spaces are related to each other, from the labyrinthic perspective, looking from one opening like this one, you would see this space, and if you would look through this door, you would see this space, and again, this opening shows that space, and so on. So all these openings that also have no doors would give an understanding of a space which consists of small units, but they all belong to each other. They form one passage, one figure of spaces. So this is also, let's say, one single space, one sequence of spaces. And this sequence will change from one level to the other and to the next level. And as you can imagine, that also the distribution, which apartment is looking on which side, is arranged in which part of the building, would change from one level to the other. This diagram is showing how the apartments develop from one floor to the other. And it's maybe the most essential, the most reduced representation of this project. And this also reveals how actually close the favela project and this project are linked together. This is how we, in the end, articulated the urban space. We first built modules that were consisting of 3, 4, 5, or 7 houses, or just one house. And then these different modules were later on attached to each other in different ways. And only because, let's say, these molecules are so different from each other, we could generate this variety of exterior space. And this is not only, let's say, a nice picture for a lecture, but this is exactly the hand sketches, following the hand sketches that were crucial for the design of the project itself. Here you show, here you see that even, you know, if this, even if this, although this space is very complex, it is built in a very simple way. It nearly looks like a game, how these different spaces and parts of the program relate to each other. Of course, we never worked like that in the office on the project, but maybe it has more to do with this quality of game. I never built any circular space in my entire life. So since these spaces were also so small, it was ideal to make a mock-up one-to-one within the office. And we also used these circular spaces. For example, all the office meetings were inside the model. We also had a bed there to see, you know, what is the perspective of this space, if from a horizontal position, etc., etc. The client is, you know, he makes bodybuilding, so he's rather strong, and we had nobody as strong as that in the office. So we asked the cook from the restaurant opposite the street if he could not try out the throne. And as you can see, it's very comfortable. And this very crucial because this geometry is so unusual and strange that actually for each wardrobe, for each toilet, we built a one-to-one space to really test if it's also a comfortable house. And all the spaces that need doors, like bathrooms or wardrobes, are between the circular spaces, so that the circular spaces could remain open and could be experienced as an entity. We during a couple of years we did several projects for China, and I loved to work in China. I have to admit it, and but obviously China didn't love me, so we never won any competition, or the commissions that we had were never built. And it's somehow strange, you know, coming from the oldest democracy that exists, Switzerland. The main reason why I like to work in China is the freedom that you have, which doesn't exist in our country. I mean, politically, yes, but if it comes to architectural competitions, it's one of the most restricted areas if you want to develop ideas in a competition. And this is also one of the reasons why many offices do not make any competitions in our country, even if it's very well paid, if you win it, otherwise not. And I guess that another reason, you know, why I like to work in China is because I didn't understand or knew China. I think if you don't understand the place where your work can become much better. Because knowledge or experience also goes together with a loss of adventure, with a loss of creativity, with a loss of innovation. So maybe these projects that we did for China are pure fantasies, you know, about a China that never existed and that maybe also never will exist. Anyway, this is Guangzhou. The tower is as big as the Eiffel Tower, no, even bigger. And this is the landmark of Guangzhou. They also have here in the background the opera by Zaha Hadid. This was the plot. The interesting thing about this commission was it was not kind of a commission for an object, but for a park with three museums. So it was the unique opportunity as an architect to not only design an object, but to design an entire landscape, and part of this landscape would be some objects, some houses. So we started with an investigation, what other buildings are there that have an interesting relationship with the landscape. You see here a building by Oskar Niemeyer, this is Vienna, this is Rome, Forbidden City, etc., etc. And it was also necessary exercise to get an understanding of the scale of this enormous plot and this enormous program, which including commercial and parking was over 250,000 square meters. So the starting point for the design of the house was that it should not be a part of the city, but a part of a landscape garden. So this is the first kind of trials, you know, how these houses could look like, so that they would obviously belong to the garden and obviously not to the surrounding city. And the, let's say, challenging thing is to also understand these houses not just as objects, but also to imagine houses that would propose a space that would belong to the landscape garden, that would be something like an extension of this landscape garden, and not as a closed space. So these are not only models, objects, but these are also representation of spaces. We will have a look at this model here, you know. This was the interior of the same model, and this interior would be big enough to relate to the landscape outside. It would be a place where people could come together, meet, rest, place big enough for trees and sculptures, where nature, people, art would come together. Another museum, this time Museum of Calligraphy, and I will show you, no, this one, this model here, made out of balloons that were cast in plaster. And again, this is a picture from the very same model, a model which is only 30 centimeters big. And just with some textures and some sculptures to give a scale. And eventually this model might look a bit childish or pure fantasy model, but in the end, if you see the model cast in concrete in the scale 1 to 100, you see that these very first initial purely conceptual studies were directly related to the final outcome of this competition, and that the scale, the relationship between the human body and the main space is actually coming from these initial studies, but also the idea that this is not just a closed space, but there are intermediate spaces that would create a sequence leading into the park surrounding this building. It's probably the only feasible project we did for China. Because it has a very simple structure. It consists of self-supporting shells, while the slabs are kind of holed with columns. So it's a very simple, basic scheme of columns and slabs. And then the roof, again, is a hanging shell structure. And also the entire facades are built out of spheres. You could also easily imagine that this is the focus point of the project, which you would have to really control, while all the rest is maybe more for the curators to decide how to arrange the spaces specifically. This is how we imagined the museum would look from outside. This was another museum, I don't remember for what, I think for science, yeah. Yeah, obviously for science. But let's say all these three museums, they were following very simple geometrical and structural rules, how they would be built up. Yeah, it's much bigger than the Pantheon. But it would also rain inside, so there's no glass roof. And they always ask for movies. Yeah. I'm sure the birds would love it. I don't know why there are so many leaves in the air. But I guess this is called artistic freedom. You know, what is a museum of calligraphy, of post-war calligraphy of Guangzhou, you know, to be very specific. And our museum was much more relating, let's say, to a workers' club, as it was built in communism, a place to educate, to entertain, and to bring people together. Much more a place of distraction than a place of contemplation. And this is the lobby which goes over the full height of the building. And maybe the, let's say, biggest effort or contribution that we did in this competition is that we didn't think of a museum as an icon, as an object, you know, that is to be shown on pictures or that you can drive by, but that it's really a space that you can enter also without paying a ticket. Also, if you are not specifically interested in post-war calligraphy from Guangzhou. Guangzhou has 8 million visitors each year, so we thought it's also important to create a space that would be an offer for all these visitors. In 2015, I was invited to make a proposal for the Swiss Pavillion, and I was quite suspicious about this invitation because I'm not very successful in Switzerland. I lost all competitions I did in the last 5 years. No matter, you know, even if we were the most economical, the cheapest, the most rational, the easiest to build, whatever quality you could have or mention that a Swiss jury could appreciate. So we thought it's quite hard, you know, to represent Switzerland as being kind of excluded from this community of Swiss architects. But and it started with an interview. You didn't have to show a project. So I went there and I was actually quite sure they would say, "Very nice to meet you, goodbye." And I said, "Well, actually, I don't like the Biennale, you know, especially not the one for architecture. I think it has nothing to do with architecture because you only see drawings, models, photography. I don't even know why it's called Biennale for architecture." Anyway, to my big surprise, they thought, "Ah, you're very critical." sounds interesting, and we were invited for the second stage. And we thought, you know, the most important thing to participate at the Biennale for Architecture in Venice is to bring back architecture to the Biennale, to build something, to make a space, to say there is no exhibition but this space, and this space is the exhibition. But then comes the second question: what space should it be? And we thought it's important that this space is exactly not a space that is referring to something else, that it's not a space that is propagandistic. There were several exhibitions in the MoMA in New York where in the courtyard a house would be built that you could visit. For example, Marcel Breuer built one beautiful pavilion. But this pavilion was also a house to live in. It was like a propaganda for a new lifestyle, propaganda for modern architecture. It was not an exhibition space. It was a house to live in that was exhibited in a courtyard of a museum. So we thought the most important quality is of this space should be that it's not referential, that it's not referring to anything else than itself. And there was about 5 days before we had to hand in this competition, total crisis, and I rejected every model there was in the office and said, this is all garbage. And, you know, even if you would take, if you would just be able to imagine the space in the garbage, it would be more exciting than all that we, you know, consciously produced so far in the office. and it would be better to make a cast of what we have in the garbage than to continue to design. So next morning, a very young, ambitious intern literally took what was in the garbage and made a plaster cast. And we were all amazed by its sheer beauty, you know, and think, this is actually the space that we are looking for, but how to build it? Maybe it's enough if you just scale it. These were other trials, you know, what is if you have plants, is it nicer to have a cast of plastic or wax or, you know. And when we won the competition, we started to, you know, increase these procedures of space design. And the studio looked much more like a laboratory for chemistry or like a kitchen. And the methods how to produce the quality of the space became more and more refined. The title Incidental Space is also to a certain extent ironic, because we did over 300 models, so you cannot really talk about the incident. These are different materials that were used, as in every, you know, good restaurant, the cook will not tell you the recipe. So no one really knows what the form of the space that in the end was built comes from, but use your own imagination. Yeah, and you know, I always think how you design physically has an impact on what comes out of it. You know, if you use a pencil, or if you use watercolor, or if you use materials, different kinds. And to a certain extent, we also try to design the design process much more than to design a space. So these are some of the 300 selection. And what was interesting is that by having different materials, you would not only receive different forms of space, but you would also receive a different ornamentation of the space. And what you see on the left is always the same model as on the right. And on the right, you see the details. So, you know, are the forms very smoothly? Do they have breaks? Are they detailed? Are they, et cetera, et cetera. My English is just not good enough to explain what are the different qualities of these. In this sense, we always looked not only at the outline, at the form of the space, but also at its detail. And these are pictures which are scaled that they would represent the same models as here in one. So the entire, let's say, selection process was always between looking at the space itself and then looking at its ornamentation. And the first room was a wallpaper room, very good for selfies, you know, for those people that have no time. Aravena himself, he said, you know, we should always think about people that only have 2 minutes. So since it's a bit complicated to enter our space, we thought, okay, in 2 minutes you can reach the wallpaper room, make a selfie and go to the next pavilion. It's also good to have something to look at, you know, at boring openings. This is one of the initial models, and this is a rendering of the same model. It's a rendering because it visualizes something which is much more abstract, which is the cloud of voxels, of singular points, which were with a 3D scan evaluated. This is actually what the scan would look like. It's more like a triangulated landscape than a form. A part of the initial model, the render, and the surface of the pavilion itself. And you could say that actually this is just a printed, 3D printed render, while this is a flat render. But they are kind of just output out of the precise same digital information. And to my knowledge, this is the only project where the render is not pure cheating, where the render is also like a construction plan. The model that was selected was the model, I think it was number 180. And here you see all the points that were necessary for the scan as referential points. It also had to be destroyed, that you could measure it from different sides. Also, this is not a picture, it's a construction plan. You see this thin line here? This is a skin of 2 centimeters of fiber concrete. I mean, does this make sense, you know, a project like this? And a lot of people, you know, asked me then, oh, what happened with you, you know? Sickness, is it contagion? You know, you always worked with structures and now this. But this is also a structure and I try to explain it, you know. This is what we do usually in architecture, column and slabs. And you see that the slab needs a certain thickness, you know, because otherwise it would not hold. And you could also imagine doing something else than increasing the thickness. And this is that you increase the surface. And what you get is a larger stiffness. And it doesn't matter, you know, how you scramble, or I don't know, scramble the right expression, the paper. It will always be stiff. And you would also, you could do reach this stiffness with less material. So in the end, there is also something extremely rational in this form. And you could think of this form as a structure, as a load-bearing structure. This is the interior shown from the outside. It's the cast that was necessary for the sprayed concrete. And for economical reasons and also to finish in time, we produced the different elements in different materials. This shows all over 200 parts, of which the entire surface was assembled. We have here the time, and this is each of these 270 parts. You know, you can see always here the cast is produced, here the spray concrete comes, here it's shipped to Venice, here it's assembled. So the whole logistics was quite challenging. And I would say with an ordinary client, or if a developer would be our client, we could never make such a project in such a short time. Part of the mold were molded in foam. This was done by students. Other parts were done with 5X milling. And other parts, which were more complex, they were 3D printed. It's actually very simple. I just wanted to show this movie that you can see how simple this project actually is. So there's a first layer. And this layer is very important to capture all the details. The details have a precision of half a millimeter. And then at the end, the third layer are the fibers that are sprayed on the mold. And this actually gives the stiffness, the stability. The man that you see here was trained in Hollywood. His specialty was to have elements that you can use in film and move very easily. For example, artificial rocks for westerns, or, you know, things like that. Very, very experienced person. Without him, the project would not be possible. The different parts before shipping. And this is how they were brought together on site. And now everything, you know, was in theory so precise, you know, half a millimeter, and only a computer can do it. Wow. But in Venice, we realized that all parts have a different precision of half a millimeter. And the joints are up to 4 centimeters. But it's also a very, let's say, simple material, you know, so all joints disappeared. pure magic. And yeah, we wanted the people to take off the shoes, but this is not because we were afraid that the space would get dirty, you know. Also not because the floor is not stable, but because we wanted that you really can feel the floor. If you go in a mosque, you also take out the shoes. Yeah, we actually more wanted kind of a respect, you know. So and that people would also more carefully, you know, behave in this space, which is actually quite a dangerous space. We are really very lucky that we had no accident at all. Because everything that is in this space is forbidden. We had some visitors. This is Patrick Schumacher. He runs the office of Zaha Hadid. I tried to explain him that this project is the future of digital fabrication. And that everything else is the past. He very hardly tries to enjoy the space. Wang Shu felt very familiar. He was telling me of monks living in caverns and relating to Chinese scholar stones. Sechima just liked it. She didn't say a word, but I guess she liked it. You know, this space is not just about challenging or about bringing the front to Venice, not reporting from the front, but bringing the front to Venice and thinking, you know, what is today feasible, how can we produce a space, how can we think, how we can imagine a space. But it is a specific project. It is an architectural project. And even if it was very adventurous in terms of finance, in terms of schedule and all this stuff, you know, the biggest adventure was how would this space be in the end? What would his quality be? And I was always afraid that this space, which covers a surface of something like 25 square meters, would look small and somehow ridiculous, you know. Now that it's kind of finished and the Biennale is over, I can admit it. This was my biggest fear. Much bigger, you know, that we cannot hold the budget or whatever, or it will be not finished at the opening and so on. Yeah, we also already had the title, you know, the unfinished space, just in case we would run out of luck. And let's say the main idea of the space is that by expanding the surface, by differentiating the surface, by having an extremely detailed surface, by having a continuous change between different ornamentations of the surface, that you would get a space that you cannot easily capture, a space that expands in different directions, a space that would look infinite. Even in reality, it is the total opposite of that. And that was you know, I think only if a project in architecture raises architectonical questions, it can have a relevance within the discipline of architecture. And I think it doesn't matter in the end if you build in China, Brazil, in Switzerland, if you build for the rich or for the poor. It only matters what are the spatial, the architectonical qualities that you can come up with. And only this also makes it acceptable that architecture is so hard to do and so expensive. And if there's something that relates to projects, I think it is that we did it both in an extremely naive way, you know. I never did any project in Brazil. I never entered a favela before I worked on this project. I was never interested in digital fabrication. I had no idea what a 3D printer is. And but these are only tools, you know, these are only possibilities what you can reveal in architecture. And I think this naivety is also in the end a reason why we were somehow as total outsiders, the first one who ever built a purely digitally fabricated space that you could walk around in it. And I think this naivety is also an absolute crucial quality. And I wanted to finish the lecture with this because some of you just started their study last week, and I think this openness or the starting point of not knowing is absolutely crucial for achieving something. Thank you.
Just a quick note for those of you exiting, we are experimenting with wine and cheese after lectures. So that's GSAPP experimentation, actually. And I do want to be mindful of the storm outside our bunker. So I think we should keep this a little bit short, but I wanted to...
No. Please stay. It's the only safe place in town.
So thank you, Christian, for an amazing lecture. And I do think that it's quite inspiring to have it at the beginning of the semester. I think you did what you set yourself to do, which is to try to kind of really create a line and a sort of consistent line of investigation between all of these projects, a real search into form and formlessness, the spatial qualities of architecture, kind of tectonic qualities, questions of repetition, of aggregation, but also I would say questions of density, which I think that to kind of it's a new understanding of tectonic, where density now is kind of playing a bigger role, and I saw that between the favela and the last project, of course, plays with scale, and especially in the collages, where often the people seemed quite small, and I was surprised even in that last image. So the kind of real sense of trying to expand space through representation, the investigation of in-between spaces, the gaps, and of course questions of solid ground. I also, you know, when I mentioned your interest in the kind of Japanese architecture of recent years, there's a somewhat of an absence of section, which I think has been not space but section as a kind of much more either volumetric or planimetric, and there's also always an abstraction, but at the same time it's always material. So the kind of the experiential, you know, comes into play. But one of the with the sort of sense of roughness, whether in the models or even in the collages, the kind of cutouts are have edges that are kind of rough. But I did want to maybe start with this question of representation, because it's very present in the presentation, but also you've mentioned it often. You know, designing the design process, you know, rather than the project itself. And going back to the question of the from the front and the kind of play between the title and the image of the German archaeologist, which I also was quite fascinated by. For me, it was a sort of question of it was for me undermining a little bit the premise of the Biennale, or creating a tension where you can't engage only from the ground if you don't create a distance and an abstraction and a representation in architecture. It's very hard to kind of advance a kind of architectural project. And so I think you know your project certainly did that. It was both from the front and on the ground, but also a kind of abstraction and a question of representation. And so I wanted maybe to stop a little bit on this question of representation for you, the question of process in the office, and the presence of drawing, but especially the presence of kind of collage and models, you know, how is it, you know, is there, for example, I guess my question would be, you're naive about the projects that you enter, or they can be first, but then there's a kind of consistency in the way that maybe you design your design process versus the kind of end product, which might be something. So the consistency would be more along the lines of your design process and search and modes of representation, rather than the kind of outcome of the project as a way to read the kind of body of work.
For me, architecture is a media, and it cannot be, to a certain extent, be represented at all. Not through photography, not through drawing, not through models. These are only tools that help you to reveal an architectonical quality. So I'm also desperate about, you know, all the things that we do to approach architecture. And in the sense, the investigation on how can you kind of use these as tools to come up with a real space at the end comes also out of this frustration or anger, you know, that constantly I think, you have to destroy everything. Everything is shit, and out of that comes again, let's say, a new also representation. So this interrogation, or this also doubt, or destructive approach to any representation produces again and again new forms of presentation. In this sense, I also kind of have an affection to photography, to drawings, to models. But this affection comes out of total distrust, and also out of a certain frustration about the boundaries of each representation. At the same time, I think that architecture is always about ideas, and all other medias than architecture itself, they always reveal one specific quality of a project. This means that the project, the idea of a project, can eventually be very well perceived or represented in another media, but never the experience of the architectural space itself. So the idea of representation, I think is absolutely crucial in architecture. But every representation has to be in the end a failure, because otherwise the building itself would be the illustration of the representation. You know, then the building would be representing, and the drawing would be the actual, let's say, artifact that would represent the idea. So in this sense, I also believe that an important contribution in architecture can be only insufficiently represented by any other media than the building itself. And all my projects, they were always thought as buildings. They are not, in this sense, visionary, you know. They are not utopian. They are all, in my fantasy, build projects. In my fantasy.
So that's very interesting and very different from, let's say, a kind of Peter Eisenman, for whom, you know, the representation is the project, and the building, it might be an illustration of that representation. But I do think that through your kind of investment in materiality, I mean, you do create, they've become objects, you know, in themselves. I mean, the presence of the material across scales, I think, is really quite special. And I wanted to maybe jump to a second question, which is sort of related. We were talking at lunch about competitions and how competitions have changed, and they used to be really the site of experimentation, and now it's become more difficult for many reasons. From one, they are underpaid, and two, they don't seem to be as much the site of kind of discourse, to the site of the exhibition, right, which has become a real space of experimentation for architecture, where in your case, especially in the last project, it is a building. It's a kind of one-to-one. That is a one-to-one in your mind, or does that represent, you know, something else? Or
no, I really am skeptical about the Biennale. I'm also always a bit frustrated if I go there and after half a day, normally I would go to a coffee shop in the Piazza San Marco, or to visit a work by Scarpa, or a museum, or just enjoy the old city, because I always think it's so real and it's so beautiful. And so often at the Biennale itself, I have the impression it's all fake and it's not even beautiful at all. So we also wanted to kind of do something which would be as beautiful as a coffee shop at the Piazza San Marco, you know, and as real. And in this sense, not relate just to the exhibition or topic of the exhibition, but to the city itself. And for me, this is a project of architecture. It's not a model. It is not just the exhibition, it's a real project. And it's maybe more real than if I would, for example, build a house for the poor, you know, and show it at the exhibition, or as another example, an airport for drones, you know, supposed to be in Africa, but standing in Venice. I mean, an airport for drones in Venice is something else than an airport for drones in Africa. And I think this difference is crucial. An airport for drones in Venice is a model. Our project was not a model, because it's not supposed to stand anywhere else in the world than in Venice, and to be visited or used by anybody else than visitors of the Biennale. In this sense, it's much more real than all other, let's say, one-to-one mock-ups. And this project was also possible, or became also kind of a necessity, because previously we did all this huge project and totally failed, you know? And I was like suffering from a lack of reality, you know? Having worked on all these large-scale projects that never will be built. And I, in the end, also felt that the complexity that I was looking for in China, that I was looking for with the large-scale projects, could also be revealed or fulfilled with a very small project. And we did something extremely small, but I would say it was as complicated as to build a high-rise building. And anyway, it was the most complicated small building in the world.
Well, I think that's very interesting. And I certainly, I think that was sort of my favorite part of the Biennale, was a kind of invitation to re-engage kind of reality. I mean, that was that was an aspect that I thought was successful. But what I'm hearing from you is also interesting in two folds. I think one is it does seem that generationally, or at least as a kind of generation of architect that is very much interested in re-engaging the real, in kind of moving, you know, in this day of an age of ultimate spectacle, I mean, you know, such as our president, you know, that there is something about the material, the reality, that is maybe, again, the future of architecture, this kind of reconnection with the material, and the idea that there is a difference between the reality and its representation, right? That there are things such as a material fact, let's say, which I think is in question right now as a kind of ultimate peak of postmodernism. And then the second aspect is the kind of post bigness for many of us, where you don't need scale to get complexity. You can actually re-engage with complexity at a kind of the scale of the body again. There's a kind of rediscovery of complexity of elements, which I think Rem's Biennale did try to kind of reinsert, right? Like, let's start again with the wall and the column and the, actually he didn't have the column as Bernard noted, but you know, that there's a kind of return to, that bigness in itself is maybe not the only. So I do think that there's a kind of line of inquiry. I mean, would you agree that these are kind of resonant at this moment?
Absolutely, yeah. It was also a project without a developer, a project without a client. We were free to do what we wanted. If we would somehow find the money for it and make it possible. And I think this is a important perspective, and I'm very fascinated by architects that also build by themselves, that are not looking for a client, but really do their own project, like Arno Brandl-Huber in Berlin, but also what Valerio Olciati built in Portugal for himself are, for me, like models, you know, that it's possible to really remain close to architecture by finding your own ways how to do it, and that this is maybe more interesting than to participate in competitions that will never raise any debate on architecture, that will not be publicly shown, that will be not publicly discussed, and that you don't get a lot of money for a competition. I think this is a major issue, not in an economical sense. This is boring to discuss. But it is about the question, what is the value of an idea? And if you don't spend a lot of money on the competition that is only on ideas, then the idea has no value. And if a competition is not a battle, which is the best idea, but it's just, you know, who has, I don't know, the best office, best working office, or whatever criteria there are, then I think it's not really exciting anymore to participate in competitions. Then it's just another form of speculation, and as incidental and random as any other speculation.
I wanted to ask one last question before maybe opening it up, but only because you noted, was it important that the last project came out of the garbage? And if so, was there a kind of dimension where it was a kind of representation of waste rather than being waste itself? And I'm only bringing that up because I do think that it is, there's a new maybe dimension to the material in the sense of kind of reality that I think interesting for architecture today, which is what do we do with waste and all that it embodies. And so that's a kind of interesting, maybe, so it's beyond the form, there's a kind of weightlessness or weight to the material itself.
Yeah, I mean, waste is interesting material. In many different ways. For example, I think what you have in a trash box is always very well ordered. You know, because what you throw first is what is on the bottom, and what you throw last is on top. So it's somehow in my office sometimes better ordered and structures than what you find in folders, where people start to think, you know, oh, maybe it should be in this chapter or should be there. Or it's a pure chronology, you know, as an example of, you know, how you can look at trash or a trash box, you know, that it's not something in any way negative, but it shows many perspective, or it could make you think in different ways. I'm fascinated by trash.
I think that's a good moment to open up. Julian, you're also fascinated by trash, so jump in.
When you describe the notion that not understanding the place you're working is productive, it's a difficult proposition for me, because on the one hand, I'm very sympathetic to your description of naivete as a kind of open-mindedness, I think, especially as a prompt for students. But I'm sure you can understand, we're also in a very sensitive political moment here where we've seen the disastrous and very far-reaching consequences of willful ignorance. And I'm wondering specifically about the relation of your favela project to the residents there. you know, you describe it as self-organizing, dynamic, as working well. But I wonder if in that description there's a kind of romance that overlooks the precarity of life there and the sort of incredibly cruel constraints under which that life unfolds. And specifically, I think one could argue that the systems or the sort of organizational systems of the favela that you're looking at are actually spatializations of fundamental structural inequalities in society. I mean, you talk about sort of constant change, which I understand is valid on the sort of small scale of a garden appearing or disappearing, but I don't imagine crime rate is suddenly dropping, or I don't imagine that residents are suddenly changing their socioeconomic status. So, you know, I wonder how you see your intervention in relation to these social sides or social symptoms of spatial conditions, or if you would in fact argue that that's not the architect's role, that the architect's role is spatial and the social is maybe not to be addressed.
Well, what I try to talk about is my perspective on the favela. I was not pretending this is reality. You know, I clearly also stated these pictures are idealizing the favela. And I wanted to show the favela maybe as Gauguin would show an island in the Pacific, you know, which is maybe also, you have diseases there and people die earlier and so on, but he showed it as a paradise. And I wanted to show it in an idealized way because it was for me an escape out of my own kind of understanding of architecture, and it had a relevance for other projects. Of course, there is also problems of crime and drug abuse and so on. And but I can say that the people from the favela, which were really very nice clients, and also one of the reasons I enjoyed to work for them. And they enjoyed what I did. So one of the reasons why we worked 5 years, even if we sometimes doubted if it will be built, was because we had this very close and intense and good, friendly, warm relationship with community leaders and people from the community. They understood that this project is also paying respect for their achievements, for what they did. Because I think it's wrong to look at the favela and say, well, this is the reason for drug abuse. I would say it's the opposite. It's also a built resistance against drug traffic to a certain extent. At least there is also all these positives aspects, and one also has to know how only few people in the end are taking advantage of all these criminal aspects, and other people are suffering and trying to defend themselves from these aspects. But I would say these are problems that I cannot solve purely as an architect. As an architect, I am doing architecture, nothing else. And I kind of insist on that because it also means that I have the freedom, you know, to do what I do as an architect. And if you don't believe in this personal freedom, if you kind of also as an architect just submit to solve problems of others or to help others, I think then you lose one of the most important political qualities that each democratic country should defend, you know. If you don't start defending this main quality by your own profession, by yourself, who else should defend it?
One more question.
Hi, thank you for the sharing. I wanted to ask about structure, because in relation to the earlier work, there was a lot of kind of cantilevers, kind of the wall and such. But now it seems to have moved on to a kind of spatial structure, right? So that the physics of it seem to have diminished and becoming few kind of object, kind of. So can you comment a bit about that, on the evolution of structure through your work?
Well, for me, the structure always comes as a consequence out of the idea of space. And the first projects were driven from a desire to create an open, wide space. And the cantilevers and let's say the lack of columns or cores was a consequent out of that desire to have a transparent, wide space. In this sense, it is a very clear change of perspective, but not from one element of architecture to another. All the work were always about qualities of space, but they were different qualities achieved with different structural elements.
One more question.
Can you elaborate about your attitude to organization? Did you always make new architecture
by means of inventing new structure or making new ornamentation? So,
What is an ornament? The semester at GSD was called Ornamental Space. And I could think of an ornament in a very abstract way, that it is an element that can be repeated, but from one element to the other, you cannot clearly distinguish. There are no borderlines. So in this sense, it is an element that can create infinity. And this is something which interests me a lot, because also in the favela project, in the end, the topic is not the small houses. The topic is much more this enormous space, a space which is maybe kind of atomized because all the squares are small, but the entity of having all these different squares one after the other, this sequence of spaces, is extremely generous, is maybe even monumental. And this is a quality that refers strongly to the quality of the ornament. But I don't think of an ornament as a decoration. I think of an ornament as a way how you can bring things together to define a space. I hate ornament. I hate decorations, you know, because decoration is something you can take away, you know. And in this sense, I would hate ornaments, you know, as something added. By the way, I was quite disappointed by the apartment from your new president. You know, it had a golden ceiling, and it was full of ornaments.
Because it's not real, that's why.
And the space was so low, it was so oppressive, you know. And this is an example of ornament, how I don't like it, you know.
He doesn't understand the place he works in.
Yeah.
And the space is so, you know, narrow, but then you have all these things. And probably the space is so low that you can better see the ornaments on the ceiling.
That's probably right. Well, thank you, Christian. This was really great. Thank you.